And now I want to introduce my friend Frank Gaffney. He heads up the Center for Security Policy. Frank Gaffney is also a sponsor of this event. Let's thank Frank Gaffney. Frank, come to the platform. And if you would, introduce Lord Malcolm Pearson.
Jerry, thank you very much. I appreciate Dr. Cook really doing the heavy lifting on the introduction. Mine is easy. This is one of the most courageous men in the free world. He is fighting what I call the war for the free world in the House of Lords in the United Kingdom. I've encouraged him to share with you some of his experiences in that particular combat arena as a man who is waging for all of us the fight of our time. My old boss Ronald Reagan used to call it every generation's existential threat to freedom. This is it, folks. I think of it as Sharia supremacism. He can talk to you about how it is manifesting itself, and most importantly, how what we're seeing in the United Kingdom today is in our future, unless we, and I mean particularly you, take the sorts of steps that he will commend to you to fight this great fight. He served with the great Margaret Thatcher prior to becoming a member of the House of Lords. I present to you Lord Malcolm Pearson of Rannoch.
Thank you very much, Fred. Thank you,
thanks. Yes, sir.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I trust you all know Frank well enough to know that he can be capable of over-generous exaggeration. And if you didn't know that, you're about to discover it in the next half an hour. Ladies and gentlemen, I also trust that it goes without saying that it's a huge honour for a maverick backbench member of the House of Lords to address an audience of such distinction here in the United States of America. I've chosen the title, Shall We Talk About Islam? Because on my side of the pond, you can't. You can say what you like about any other religion, and nobody takes much notice. But as soon as you say something like, hey, I'd like to learn a bit more about this Muhammad chap and his religion of peace with its Sharia law and what looks to me like a pretty violent history, and all hell breaks loose. You become an Islamophobic bigot, stirring up hatred against our peaceful Muslim friends. And I know that because I've been saying that sort of thing in the Lords for the last 8 years. And I'll give you a few examples of what happens there and in our national media in a few moments. But before that, I would like to look at some of the absolute basics of the Muslim religion and its Sharia law, which is, of course, the same thing. Please forgive me if you know all this already, but it's amazing how many people in the United Kingdom either don't know these basic facts or haven't bothered to think them through. Islam is a religion of peace, they intone, and that's as far as they get. So first I would remind you that Islam does not mean peace, as David said. It means submission, and submission to the will of Allah, or the Muslim God and its Sharia law. Second, Islam and its Sharia law are a single legal, political, and religious system, taking all authority from the Quran and from what Muhammad did and said in his lifetime from 570 to 632 AD. So Islam is completely different and incompatible with our Judeo-Christian liberal democracies, with our separation of powers between elected parliaments, or Congress, the executive, the judiciary, and in our case, the church. With us, the law can be changed if the government of the day, elected by the people, decides it should be changed, and if Parliament or Congress agrees. Our parliaments and governments can be changed every 4 or 5 years by our people, in whom ultimate sovereignty lies. But ladies and gentlemen, we the people simply doesn't work with Islam. Muslims believe that the Quran was dictated personally to Muhammad by an angel, that it is eternal, perfectly preserved, and therefore not open to criticism or change. There is only one original Quran. But within this overriding architecture, there are three very worrying Muslim tenets, which appear to be accepted by all active and authoritative Muslims, and I'd like to mention to you now. The first is to me the most important and worrying, which is the Muslim tenet of abrogation. This holds that where there is any conflict in the Quran, the later verses abrogate or cancel the earlier verses. And the worrying thing about this, ladies and gentlemen, is that as Muhammad went through life, and especially after he moved from Mecca to Medina in 622, what he wrote and what he did became steadily more violent until he took over Medina in 627 and Islam went on to conquer most of the known world. So, for instance, the much-quoted early verse, "Let there be no compulsion in religion," comes from his time in Mecca before he moved to Medina, and is one of the so-called verses of peace. But it is abrogated or nullified over 100 times in the later verses, generally referred to as the verses of the sword. My second worrying Muslim tenet, ladies and gentlemen, is al-Hijra, by which Muslims are enjoined to follow Muhammad's example after he arrived in Medina. When he had accepted his multi-faith host's hospitality for 5 years, his new religion was so strong that he could force his hosts to choose between conversion to it, exile, or death. And he ordered the death of several hundred people. It is this example of Muhammad which has become the Muslim tenet of al-Hijra, by which Muslims are instructed to convert their host societies to Islam. I don't know if you've noticed it over here, but we've had quite a scandal in the United Kingdom because a number of our schools in Birmingham and elsewhere have been taken over by hardline Muslims. One of those schools is actually called the Al-Hijra School. So Al-Hijra is alive and well in the United Kingdom today. My third worrying Muslim tenet would be taqiyya, by which Muslims living outside the Muslim world are encouraged to deceive their hosts in order to advance Islam. I'll give you a good example of taqiyya in the United Kingdom in 2014. Two of our faithful and thoroughly decent British volunteer aid workers in Syria, David Haynes and Alan Henning, had just been brutally beheaded by the Islamic State savages. No less than 119 British imams and Muslim leaders wrote to one of our national newspapers to assure us all that these evil acts, and I quote, "are nowhere justified in the Quran," end of quote. To back this up, they quoted from Surah 5, verse 32 of the Quran, as follows: "Whosoever kills a human being, it is as though he had killed the entire human race." Well, that sounds pretty peaceful, until you fill in the dots. The dots, the missing words in the Quran, go as follows: "unless it be for murder or for spreading mischief in the land." So the Quran actually says that it's okay to kill someone for spreading mischief in the land, which to our Islamist friends means anything which frustrates the advance of Islam. And if there is any doubt about that, the very next verse in the Quran, Surah 5:33, confirms that the jihadists have got it right. It goes as follows: "The punishment of those who wage war against Allah and his apostle," that's Muhammad, of course, "the punishment and those who strive with might and main for mischief in the land is execution or crucifixion or the cutting off of hands and feet from appropriate sides." So they completely misled the British people, and they must have known they were doing it because they were Quranic experts. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's taqiyya for you. 119 British Muslims deliberately misleading us by pretending that the Quran did not justify the savage murder of two thoroughly good people who were spreading mischief in the land by doing their best to help the victims of Islamist brutality. So if we're going to talk about Islam, I suggest we start by asking our Muslim leaders about abrogation, al-Hijra, and taqiyya. Do they stand by them, or do they try to get out of them? Well, will they declare them, for instance, null and void? Will our weak liberal intelligentsia join in the discussion? I doubt it. And in my recent experiences in the Lords, we'll prove that. On the 12th of December and the 27th of January, I asked our government in front of a full house whether it would, the government would encourage our Muslim leaders to re-examine the Muslim tenets of abrogation, al-Hijra and Taqiyya. The answer I got was that I was stirring up Islamophobic hatred by daring to ask such questions. Going a bit further back, I don't know if you remembered when one of our soldiers, Drummer Rigby, was murdered in the streets of London by two Islamist brothers in May 2013. The murderers gave a handwritten note to a bystander in which they quoted six verses of the Quran which justified their actions. I've got a copy of the note from their eventual trial, stained in Drummer Rigby's blood, and I have it here. Eventually, we had a statement in Parliament by the then Prime Minister, David Cameron, as to why our security service hasn't picked the brothers up before they struck. The Prime Minister and every politician and every newslet which covered the story went on out of their way to stress that Islam was a religion of peace, which the murderers had betrayed. So I got up and asked if it was helpful or accurate to go on intoning that Islam was a religion of peace. Wouldn't it have been more helpful, I suggested, to ask our Muslim leaders to look at the violence in the Quran and in the life and example of Muhammad, and to see how it could be reinterpreted? An innocent enough question, you would have thought, ladies and gentlemen, but you would have been wrong. The liberal press went mad, and two Muslim members of the House of Commons wrote to the Speaker of the House of Lords demanding that I be thrown out for the crime of hate speech, and so on. Luckily, the mechanism doesn't exist in the Lords for that, or no doubt I would have been. It might just be worth reading those six verses. Surah 484, fight in Allah's cause, for he is stronger in might and in punishing. March forth and give your lives and wealth in the cause of Allah. Surah 941. Surah 939, if you don't march in Allah in jihad, Allah will punish you and replace you with another people. And better still, 923, believers, fight the disbelievers close to you with harshness, for Allah is with you. And then, why do believers prefer to hold back rather than participate in Allah's jihad? And Surah 226, jihad, fighting in Allah's cause, is ordained for you and is good for you, so like it. So those were the verses actually written down by the brothers and given to nearby bystanders. So this brings me to hate speech itself. It seems to me that this newish crime is being cleverly used by Islam and its apologists to promote itself over our long-established tradition of free speech. We have the United Nations Human Rights Council Resolution 1618 of 2011, which prohibits the defamation of Islam. And we had a near squeak in the United Kingdom in 2006 when the Lords blocked a proposal to make it a criminal offence to criticise Islam, and the House of Commons failed to overturn us by only two votes. But the question I would ask about hate speech in its Islamic context is this: where is the hate? Does it not reside in the breast of the Islamist? And is it not directed against all who do not share his evil creed? So how can we be guilty of hate when we merely point this out and unleash their hatred against us? And and thank you, ladies. And does it make sense to turn Islamophobia into some sort of parallel crime? A phobia is an unreasonable fear of something. But is it unreasonable to fear a violent ideology which, by the end of last year, had killed 207,857 people since 9/11, or 35 a day? In 32,528 attacks, or 5.6 a day, and that's leaving the wars in North Africa out, ladies and gentlemen. I get these figures from the Religion of Peace website, which is not for the faint-hearted, but which I have not seen refuted in detail by our Muslim leaders. This website has the distinction of just having been banned from the Palace of Westminster and our parliamentary estate. You simply can't get it if you're in the parliamentary estate. And I've put down a written question to ask why. I have no doubt that I will be told that it has been banned because it carries a lot of hate speech. But how do we know if we aren't allowed to discuss its accuracy, if we can't talk about its contents with our Muslim leaders, because they won't engage with us, and because that in itself would make us guilty of Islamophobia? So it's heads they win and tails we lose, and Islam advances steadily. And of course, we mustn't forget that the Muslim birth rate is very much higher than ours. Figures I've been given by our own government suggest that our Muslim population is going up by about 75% every 10 years, and that around 30% of our Muslims are under the age of 14, about double the figure for the rest of our population. But then Sharia law allows a man four wives, most of whom are having at least two children, and each of which he can divorce by merely saying, "I divorce you," three times. But his wives can't do the same. It is this soaring comparative birth rate which led a very senior Muslim leader to say to a friend of mine recently, "You know, we really don't need to go on blowing you up with our suicide bombers and other atrocities. All we have to do is to wait until we will take over your culture through the power of the womb and the ballot box." And that is what we're going to do. Ladies and gentlemen, Sharia law also discriminates against women in matters of inheritance, custody of children, evidence in a Sharia court, where a man's evidence is worth double that of a woman. We have about 87 of these courts in the United Kingdom, which are called Muslim arbitration tribunals, but which in truth mean that Sharia law is running de facto in our land, especially in our 10 largest Muslim communities, which refuse to integrate with our wider society. Sharia is also brutal, of course, towards gays and others. One thing, ladies and gentlemen, I've never understood is why our left doesn't object violently against all this. But for some reason, they don't. And it's left to rabid right-wingers like me to point it all out and to say that it should be stopped before it's too late. And I'm afraid that stopping it could be easier said than done in Europe now. Because what I have said about the UK applies just as much to the rest of Europe, if not more so, for instance, in Holland, France, and much of Scandinavia. But you here in the United States have a chance of avoiding this coming cultural catastrophe, especially under your new president, Donald Trump, who clearly has a pretty good grasp of the problem. So, I hope it's helpful if I tell you of some of the initiatives which we are trying to pursue in Europe and which you may want to try here. The first would be to follow what Baroness Caroline Cox, who spoke here 2 years ago, is trying to do in our Parliament. She has introduced a bill which is called the Arbitration and Mediation Services Equality Bill, which is quite a good disguise, and it had its second reading on the 27th of January last. So you can look up the debate in the House of Lords website if you're interested. Its basic purpose is to make it a criminal offence for any system of foreign law to take precedence over our own law. So the judgments of our Sharia courts would become illegal where they conflict with our own legal system, unless both sides to any dispute genuinely accept them. Caroline now has the testimony of many brave Muslim women who have come forward with their distressing stories of how they have been treated by their husbands and menfolk under Sharia law in our country today, and it's very harrowing, ladies and gentlemen. Many of them have been imported by their families from Pakistan and elsewhere and don't speak English. And so they don't understand that they are not protected by our civil law if they have not registered their marriage in a civil ceremony in the United Kingdom. And that's another thing that could be done, to outlaw sham Sharia marriages, unless the women in question speak good enough English to show that they understand that the benefits of a civil marriage are not available to them under their Sharia law or in their Sharia courts. Ladies and gentlemen, every single peer who spoke in Caroline's second reading on the 27th of January supported the bill, except, of course, the government minister, who said it wasn't necessary because the government has such wonderful initiatives as what is called our Prevent Programme, which is supposed to turn young Muslims away from jihad and into the paths of civilized righteousness through interfaith dialogue and similar initiatives, but which have little effect on our hardline Muslims in their communities. In fact, an interesting statistic is that only 1 in 8 of the tip-offs to our security services about potential jihadists come from within our homegrown Muslim communities. Only 1 in 8. And around 35% of our Muslims say they want to live under Sharia law and will vote for it when they get the chance. The population of Brussels will be majority Muslim in 20 years, and many of our Muslim conurbations will be majority Muslim before that. Back to the power of the womb and the ballot box, of course, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway, I'm sure we can provide the link to Caroline's debate on the 27th of January for anyone who's interested. It is a very educational but very depressing read. Another hopeful initiative is being run by Dr. Jay Smith, who you can also look up on Google, and many of you may have heard of him. Together with two brave Turkish Muslim scholars, he is researching the historic origins of the Quran. Remember that Muslims believe, or are supposed to believe, that there is only one divinely inspired version, unarguable and eternal. But Jay and his colleagues have unearthed at least 6 different early manuscripts, none of which agree with each other, and no less than 26 different early Arabic Qurans. It also appears that the very earliest mosques were built facing Petra, not Mecca. I wonder why. Ladies and gentlemen, we would have thought that this is the sort of research which should be open to international debate with the scholarly Muslim community. But so far, you would be wrong. If Jay's research becomes accepted, it is something of an earthquake under the jihadist position. And I hope he is spared to take it forward. He is a very brave man. Another obvious thing to do is to ban all face coverings in public places. Such a ban would not be specific to the burqa, of course. It would include balaclavas and head stockings and so on. But it would sweep up the burqa and the niqab in its effect. Isn't that just plain, simple security precaution? You'd have thought so. But one of our chief police constables in one of our more Muslim areas has just suggested that women police officers should be encouraged to wear the burqa when in uniform. So, once again, the drift is going the wrong way. And of course, we've got to get at what is going on in our mosques and in our madrasas, the schools attached to each mosque. This is where the seeds of future jihad are still being sown, mostly in Arabic and Urdu, which not many of us understand. Perhaps we should insist that all lessons and all sermons are delivered in English, which a large percentage of our imams cannot even speak. So there is some way to go with the whole of this area. There is perhaps a small ray of hope here in that some of our Church of England schools are now taking in quite large numbers of Muslim children. In fact, Muslim children outnumber Christian children in more than 30 of our church schools. And at one church primary school, all its children have been Muslims. And the parents of these children do seem to support the idea that their children are being prepared for life in modern Britain. But we have to be careful that this isn't our old friend Takia again. Are they just learning all about it, but still determined as they grow up to destroy it? Anyway, we could do with more of this sort of thing. I should report, too, that there is a growing movement amongst our agnostic community which is coming out strongly against Sharia law and Islamism. In this context, I would mention One Law for All, which again you can look up. Many Muslims, particularly women, who leave the Muslim faith and thus risk the death penalty for apostasy, do not make the whole journey to faith in Jesus Christ. They turn against all religion and join organizations such as One Law for All and other agnostic and even atheistic organizations. Now, I know this may not be a particularly welcome development with this audience, but we are so desperate now that I fear it may be a case of my enemy's enemy is my friend. And I believe that we must make common cause with them, many of whom have been very brave in the face of family and Islamic intimidation. And what else can we do, practically as individuals? Well, could I recommend that we support Faith Leaders for America, which has the wonderful byline, rejecting intolerance under the guise of tolerance. One other thing we could do, and I have been doing, is we should suggest to the Muslim leaders that they hold a great council and that they make it official that the earlier verses of the Quran are the ones that count and the later verses of the verses of the sword didn't. They've had nothing like that. We, after all, ladies and gentlemen, had the council of Nicaea and the Council of Trent. Hundreds of years ago we did it. They haven't done it yet. It's something we should suggest. I have suggested it in the Lords and elsewhere, and I can tell you it hasn't been very well received. I think we all also need to be clear that the Muslim Brotherhood is enemy number one and must be resisted on all fronts and destroyed as soon as possible. I take great comfort from the fact that President Trump has got Islam clearly into perspective. In this area, at least, his election seems to me to be something of a miracle. Ladies and gentlemen, I would end by nailing one of the most pervasive platitudes which one comes up against in this whole question as to whether we can talk freely about Islam, or whether we are to go on being silenced by the aggressive political correctitude of our political and journalistic class. This platitude, ladies and gentlemen, is the regular reply when you mention this subject, "Oh, but there is a lot of violence in the Bible too, isn't there?" I meet it all the time, and from people who should know better. I don't need to tell this audience that there is indeed quite a bit of violence in the Old Testament. Jehovah did indeed go around smiting the uncircumcised from time to time. But the point is that Orthodox Jews are not murdering hundreds of thousands of innocent people on the strength of it. And the point is also, of course, that the New Testament is, and its founder, are entirely good. And your ministry is by far the best chance we have of defeating this growing evil in our midst. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another. So I hope it doesn't offend you if I say that I do not think we will defeat this great Islamist Satan by the power of love alone. As far as I'm aware, Jesus did not tell us to turn the other cheek to the devil. And so, my friends, onward, Christian soldiers.